Cracker Barrel Old Country Stores invite you to join them for Path to Stardom. This week's guest is Marty Stewart. Marty grew up as a child performer on the Grand Ole Opry stage. No one understands stardom better than Marty.
These days, what really means the most to me is doing right, as best I know how, with every strength I have, and turning in an honest day's work so at the end of the day I can look to God and say, thank you for sustaining me. Thank you for protection. Thank you for the endurance. Thank you for your grace. And thank you for the opportunities. I hope I didn't let you down too much.
In the pouring rain, take along your baby just cause you in love. Fishing and loving, I can't get enough. Well, that's country. I was raised a country child. That's country. Baby, that's my style.
I come from Rowdy, Philadelphia, Mississippi. It's a nice country town, has a lot of dignity. The people there are its main thing, I think. I miss home sometimes. I get real lonesome for it. That's when I go back. And my mom gave me a great piece of advice one time. She said, you know, if nothing's going on in your life, there's nothing happening, there's always plenty of work to do on the inside if there's nothing going on the outside. And what you do is go back home and be still and be patient and wait. So home is still Philadelphia, Mississippi. And I still go down there, like I said, when I need to gather some vision, power, strength. My first memory period on this earth is of, we had a house over in town and being in my mom's arms late one afternoon. And across the street or across town, the Methodist Church, the bells started ringing at the end of the day. And I just started crying and hanging on. I remember what her dress looked like. And I was just hanging on to her crying. I didn't know why I was crying. And looking back on it, I see that that was the first time I really heard music, and it really got inside of me. And music still makes me cry.
10 years ago, on a cold, dark night, someone was killed neath the town hall light. There were few at the scene, but they all agreed that the slayer who ran looked a lot like me. Well, the judge said, son, what is your alibi? If you were somewhere else, then you won't have to die. I spoke not a word, though it meant my life. I had been in the arms of my best friend's wife. She walks these hills in a long black veil. She visits my grave when the night winds wail. Nobody knows, nobody sees, nobody knows but me.
When I first went into Lester Flatt's band, that was a pretty staunch fraternity. It was a fun, the minute the door shut on the bus, I mean, the rules were very well set, and everybody knew how to act and what to do. I don't think my mom and dad would have let me go on the road with Metallica back then, but being that it was Lester Flatt, Lester was kind of like a grandpa. I lived at his house with him and his wife, Gladys.
Well, the scaffold is high, eternity's near. She stood in the crowd and shed not a tear. But sometimes at night, when a cold wind moans in a long black veil, she cries over my bones. She walks these hills in a long black veil. She visits my grave when the night winds wail. Nobody knows, nobody sees, nobody knows but me. Nobody knows, nobody sees, nobody knows but me.
Lester's peers were like Roy Acuff, Ernest Tubb, String Bean, Grandpa Jones, Bill Monroe, those kind of people. And that's who I hung around with because I wasn't old enough to drive and I rode with Lester. So that's who I played poker with. That's who I hung out with and played music and talked music in old times with. And it just let me in on the wisdom of the masters. I'm talking about the guys that invented country music as we know it today. I got to see it firsthand. I got to talk to them. I wish all my peers that are on the charts these days and that are making country music could have just had access to the knowledge, whether you use it or not, is there's something in it for everybody. The only straight piece of advice he ever gave me is the very first weekend I was out on the road with him, he said, come here. And he set me down in the front of his bus and there were two elderly people walking toward the bus. He said, see those people? They've been coming to see me since me and Earl Scruggs were in Bill Monroe's band in 1945. That's what country fans are all about. You just love them and they'll take care of you. And they'll stick with you. But don't ever high-nose them. Don't refuse autographs. Don't do those kind of things. That's all it takes to keep country fans. Lester Flatt died in 1979. I remember thinking, what am I going to do? Is there anything out there beyond this? And I called up my buddy Vassar Clemens, who I knew that I wanted to go out and explore music beyond just bluegrass music. I knew that that was set down in my soul and I loved it and I had a place for it for the rest of my life. It's like church hymns. And I wanted to go and find different avenues in music. I always thought of country music as kind of being a futuristic kind of thing, even though we come, you know, from deep long ago. Country music's future is unlimited. I think there's unlimited potential and I would love to be one of the first hillbillies to go to the moon and, you know, play some country music, maybe bluegrass music even. John R. Cass, Johnny Cass. I love Johnny Cass. He's like a daddy, you know. He's the reason I play country music. The first two records we ever had in our house, the country records, was the fabulous sound of Johnny Cass and Flatt and Scruggs' greatest hits. Cass was different. I had good taste for a five-year-old kid, you know what I mean? That sound like a young cowboy named Billy Joe grew restless on the farm. A boy filled with wanderlust who really meant no harm. He changed his clothes and shined his boots and combed his dark hair down. But his mother cried as he walked out, don't take your guns to town, son. Leave your guns at home, Bill. Don't take your guns to town. That sound got me. I loved running the roads with Johnny Cash. Here's what working with Cash taught me. I've stood beside him at the border in Budapest and see, he his presence wrecks a room. People don't even understand what he's saying. Just clap along and chant, do I walk the line? I've seen the power that comes out of him. And when he's right, he's probably one of the most charismatic people on this earth. He's so chosen. He's a special person. Running the roads with those guys, that band had a pretty good history of, you know, destruction, tearing up hotels and practical jokes and things like that. I got in on the tail end of that and was proud to be a part of it, but that's a way of life that's almost gone by these days. I just got into stretching out to see what the other side was all about. And the only person I ever hurt was myself. And the rocking years, as I call them, the idiot years, there's really not that much wrong with them. I probably needed to get through them. I'd rather do them on the front side. If it's in you to do, which it was me. I wanted to get it over with and burn it out just as quick as I could, get it out of me, so I wouldn't get to midlife and do it. These days, I live in a constant state of prayer because I realize that when I'm out there on the road, it's a fight, it's a struggle, it's hand-to-hand combat. Anytime you leave the safety of your home and leave your family behind. So I think that prayer means more to me right now than it ever has. I'm very much in touch with my Heavenly Father. Has my heart ever been broken? No, never. Of course not. Let me just say like this. I can't seem to get love right. I hold it for a moment, then it's gone. It breaks my heart, then it fades out of sight. I can't seem to get love right. But tomorrow is another day. And who knows what might come my way. Maybe there'll be a ship in the night. But I can't seem to get love right. Nah, my heart's never been broke. Not once. Music comes from heaven. Music comes from God. Sometimes I think I stand in the way of what he's trying to send. It's real important to stay out of the way and just kind of be the vessel that it flows through. Just kind of hang on to the pen and see what happens. That's truthfully where the best songs that I've ever written came from. I know that. Why do I wear my hair this way? Because it won't go any other way. One time I met a man that looked like Albert Einstein in a truck stop in Dismal, Iowa. So I liked him, and then I went further on down the line, I saw this guy that thought he was Porter Wagner. I liked that a lot. Then there was this guy that looked like Bob Dylan one time out in California. So between those three and, you know, that guy on a $20 bill, you know, I thought, these guys have a lick going. And besides the fact that I can't get my hair to do anything else, it takes about 3 minutes to get it looked this bad, so there's really nothing to it. You ought to try it sometimes. I'd recommend it out there highly. You need a 60-mile-an-hour wind, a can of Aquanet, $1.50 hairbrush, and you're in. You can do it, too. If you want to look ridiculous, you can do it, too. The clothes I wear, I don't know. I love the old costumes of the old country stars and the cowboy singing stars. I love the way Roy Rogers looked. I love the way Gene Autry wore his boots. I love Porter Wagner's clothes. I love Johnny Cash's clothes. I love Elvis's clothes, Little Richard, Bob Dylan. John Wayne, all those guys had identifiable images. Manuel, the guy that makes my clothes sometimes, he said that if you see a star, a shadow on the wall, you should be able to know who that star is simply by looking at their shadow on the wall. That pretty well sets it up for the image. And, you know, I can look on the wall and tell who I am sometimes. What you see with me is pretty much what you get, for better or for worse. I'm comfortable with me. I know what I can do, know my limitations of what I can't do. I know what I am, know what I ain't. Part good and part bad, that's what makes all of us up. I'm just a guy trying. Aretha Franklin said something one time that was so great. She said, I've sang my whole life with my hand out, just hoping somebody would take my hands and hear my music. I thought, there you go, Aretha. Kind of the same thing, always hoping somebody would take it, shake it, make friends. Am I still a kid at heart? Yeah. Fun is what it's all about to me. If I can't have fun, I don't do it much anymore. Fun. Playing music ought to be fun. When it turns into a job, I try to figure another way out of it. Because it's hard work, but I love having fun. Yeah. If I went to the moon, I'd definitely wear a cowboy hat. Because who knows, you might run into somebody, and you really need to have a hat on when you go to the moon. But if you run into somebody on the moon, if you got your hat on, I think it's real important to tip your hat, because if you're gonna wear a hat, you ought to tip your hat to ladies and things like that. So you really need to be careful what you wear on your head. Bah! Wait a minute, I got one more thing to add to that. Ah! Okay. Any ducks up here? I believe in the past, present, and future of country music. I believe in all that's gone before us. I believe in offering praise and dignity and honor to those people that paved the highway for the likes of me and Dwight Yoakam and Travis Tritt and Garth Brooks to travel. I'm talking about those pioneers. I think there's room in it for everybody. The 21st century's drawing close. Walking my own path means delivering a piece of that as well as the present and whatever the future may hold into the 21st century safely. I think I was not given access to that master wisdom and those masters' music just to throw away. I think it's important that a few of us, and there are a few of us, that have the roots of country music in our hand. And I think it's our job to get out there and deliver it and take the truth to the people as well as the trend. And so that's my path. And like I said, to be on a first name basis with as many people as I can, to spread the inspiration of country music, to crusade for hillbilly music and what we really stand for around here. That's my path. And if that means that I'm a little different or a maverick, well, so be it. I'll take the consequences. Hillbilly heaven is a magical, mythical place out there somewhere, probably around Alpha Centauri. It's made up of dreamers, poets, clowns, pickers, sinners, saints. Our favorite hillbilly pickers and singers, mainly. We used to travel three years ago on Ernest Tubbs' last tour bus. And we were going through West Virginia one day. I was in the back room, and that room was so magic itself. You could open the curtains, throw a piece of paper down there, the table would just write a song by itself. And the sign we went by said, "Welcome to Oak Hill, West Virginia." And I thought, what do I know about this town? I know about Oak Hill, West Virginia. What? And I rediscovered that that's where Hank Williams Sr. died on the way to Canton, Ohio, in the back seat of his car, on his way to do his New Year's Eve show that he never made. And so I was just sitting there minding my own business sometimes and went. Last night I dreamed I went to hillbilly heaven. Oh, what a beautiful sight. St. Peter come up to me and he said, "Marty, now who do you want to see?" So I said, "Sir, why don't you call up old Hank Williams and see if he's free? Because Hank saw this world from a Cadillac and he carried them lovesick blues right on his back. Oh, yeah. Yes, sir." And just as sure as I was dreaming, just as sure as I was born, round my neck came this long, skinny arm. He said, "Howdy, hoss. My name is Hank. Now, what brings you here?" So I began to think. I said, "Hank, brother, you've seen it all. You've seen them come and go, and you've seen them rise and fall. Right now, country music's got more singers than I've ever seen. So many people got to follow out their dream. But I feel different," I said, "Hank, because I'm a natural-born cat. I'm country to the bone, son, but I can't wear no hat. No, sir." Said I started with Lester Flatt, you know, back in 72. All I wanted to be was a little different, like him and you. Hank said, "Now, whoa, boy, if you plan to be different, you're just rolling the dice. And you know you ain't the first one to pay that price. Because there's already been folks like me and Elvis. There was Bo Cephas, too. There was Waylon and Willie and old Bill Monroe. And I guess you knew all about Johnny Cash. But, son, what the world needs right now is a jumping Jack Flash, yeah. Up in hillbilly heaven, I saw Keith Whitley. I saw Patsy Cline. I saw Reba McEntire's band. They were all friends of mine. And I began to tremble and I began to look. But I knew I was dreaming, but I just couldn't wake up. And then out of nowhere came this long Cadillac and the driver said, "Come on now, Hank, we gotta take you back. We got 30 minutes before your next show, but running way behind. So we gotta go." Hank said, "Marty, tell you what you do, you just go on back down there and make us proud. But remember, wherever you go and play, there's gonna be a little hillbilly in every crowd." And he got an old car. And he drove off real slow. But right here is what old Hank said to me before he shut that door. He said, "To tell you, my name is Marty Stewart, and you've been watching Path to Stardom. Thank you for joining us. Good night. Well, one time the Pope was speaking at the Waldorf Astoria. And so he walks out and his Pope mobile isn't there and he says, I need a taxi. He told the taxi driver, he says, Hoss, I said, I've got to get to the airport. My plane's waiting, I have to speak at the Vatican in the morning. Now I have to go to the Vatican, he says, and drive fast. Cab driver says, yeah, get in. So about 15 minutes later, they're driving along about 40 miles an hour. The Pope says, sir, please. He says, I really have to get to the airplane. So the driver says, yeah. So finally, the Pope says, you get in the back seat, I'll drive. And so the Pope gets in the taxi, takes off, cop stops him. So the cop says, could I see your driver's license? The Pope says, sure. Hands him his driver's license. He says, the cop says, I'll be right back. He goes to his car, he says, I need the chief. I've really got a big one here. He says, what do you mean? You stopped the mayor? He says, no, bigger than that. He says, what do you mean? You stopped the governor? He says, no, bigger than that. He says, don't tell me you stopped Clinton. He says, no, bigger than that. He says, matter of fact, I don't know who the guy is, but he's got the Pope driving him around New York City. That's all, folks. It's the only clean joke I know.